Lamar, will you lead us in prayer, please?
John saw a city that could not be hid.
John saw that city.
Oh, yes, he did. John caught a glimpse of the golden throne.
Tell
city of God.
Goodness of God.
I love your voice. You have led me through the fire in darkest nights. You are close like no other. I've known you as a father. I've known you as a friend. And I have lived in the goodness. And all my love, you have been faithful. And all my love, you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, I'm surrendering now. I give you everything. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, I'm surrendering now. I give you everything. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. And all my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. I sing of your love. And all my love, you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. Oh, I will sing of the goodness of
I am not skilled to understand what God has willed, what God has planned. I only know at His right hand stands one who is my Savior. I take Him at His word indeed. Christ died to save me, this I read. And in my heart I find a need of Him to be my Savior. That He would leave His place on high and come for sinful man to die. You count it strange, so once did I, before I knew my Savior.
My Savior loves, my Savior is, my Savior's always there for me. My God, He was, my God, He is, my God, He's always gonna be. My Savior loves, my Savior is, my Savior's always there for me. My God, He was, my God, He is, my God, He's always gonna be.
Yes, living, dying, let me bring my strength, my soul is from the spring that He who lives to be my King once died to be my Savior, that He would leave His place on high and come for sinful man to die. You count it strange how once did I, before I knew my Savior.
My Savior loves, my Savior lives, my Savior's always there for me. My God, He was, my God, He is, my God, He's always gonna be. My Savior loves, my Savior lives, my Savior's always there for me. My God, He was, my God, He is, my God, He's always gonna be.
My strength, my soul is from His spring, that He who lives to be my King once died to be my Savior, that He who lives to be my King once died to be my Savior. My Savior and my
Wonderful name it is. I may not make it through these announcements. What a powerful name it is. Y'all glad to be here this morning? Yes. If you ain't, there's something wrong with you. Want to thank Sister Lucille, Sister Shirley, and Sister Pat for the decorating the church. When I walked in this morning, it jumped out, and it's so beautiful. Want to welcome our visitors. Y'all hadn't heard me talk too much about this lately, but sitting there listening to them songs this morning, 2013, 8 years ago, the 15th of April, I went through something that the only thing I can tell you is God wasn't through with me. That's why I'm still here. You know, we let things slide so many times and we don't thank it. If there's anybody in this building this morning that ain't got a miracle that they can thank God for, I don't know. But he has blessed me beyond what I deserve. He has given me, because I told the daughters, that's the only thing I can tell you is God ain't through with me. And I've got to thank my wife for being there for me all these years. She takes good care of me. She tries to keep me straight. You heard that try word, didn't you? But I do want to thank each one of you for turning aside to come this morning. This is the time of the season, Christ's death, burial, and resurrection, of what our, he died on that cross for my sins. He shed his blood for my sins. And, you know, every one of those songs this morning just should uplift so many Christians, because he is there. He is there for us. And this is the amazing thing. The more of his will that we let be done in our life, guess what? We become the more joyful person. And I don't know how Brother Brandon is going to outdo this song service this morning, but I know God has a blessing laid on our heart. I want to remember the Inez Riggins family. She passed away Friday. There were two more in our county also yesterday. We need to remember those families. Or we could all be somewhere where these other people were at, in a hospital, shut up at home, can't get out. So it's a blessing to be able, if nothing else, to come to God's house and worship him, our true and living Savior. Let's pray. Our most kind and gracious Heavenly Father, I come to you with a humble heart, Lord. Thank you for the blessing of life, Lord, health and strength, Lord. We just thank you for your love that you bestow upon us, Lord. We ask that you be with the families of lost loved ones, Lord. Be with the families that are dealing with these physical illnesses and also spiritual illnesses, Lord. We just ask you to reach down and comfort them as only you can, Lord. We just ask you to be with our world leaders from the church house to the White House, Lord, that they turn back to your will, Lord, to your way of what your word says, Lord. And we just ask you to give us the strength to let your will be done in our life, Lord. We just ask you to be with Brother Brandon. He brings your message this morning, Lord. Anoint him with the words that we need to hear, Lord, most of all that we apply to everyday lives. For it is your Son, Jesus Christ's name, I do humbly pray. Amen. Brother Brandon.
Good morning. In the Gospel of John, chapter 19, after Jesus had been beaten and stripped naked, put a crown of thorns on his head and robed in a purple garment, Pontius Pilate brought him out before the people. The people that a few days before had been crying, "Hosanna, Hosanna to God in the highest." And he brought him out before all the people, and he said unto them these famous words. He said, "Behold the man." My goal today is that when we get done here, you will have beholden the man. You will have seen the man, the God-man, Jesus Christ. I'm so excited today to preach this message to you, the death and burial of Jesus Christ. Just like Paul said, "I have determined to know nothing among you except Jesus Christ and him crucified." And if I could preach anything, if this was the last day that I could ever preach, if I was going to die tomorrow, I would not want to preach any sermon but this sermon I have for you today. If you'll open up your Bibles to the Gospel of Matthew chapter 27, let's get started today. Matthew chapter 27. Verse 11. Matthew 27, verse 11. Matthew 27, 11. "And Jesus stood before the governor, and the governor asked him, saying, Art thou the king of the Jews? And Jesus said unto him, Thou sayest. And when he was accused of the chief priests and the elders, he answered nothing. And then said Pilate unto him, Hearest thou not how many things they witness against thee? And he answered to him never a word, insomuch that the governor marveled greatly. Now at the feast of the governor was wont to release unto the people a prisoner whom they would. And they had then a notable prisoner called Barabbas. Therefore, when they were gathered together, Pilate said unto them, who will ye that I should release unto you, Barabbas or Jesus, which is called the Christ? Let me tell you something of that word, Christ. That word, we call Jesus Christ all the time. We say Jesus Christ like it's his last name. The word Christ is a word which means the anointed one. And even Pontius Pilate, a heathen, a pagan, said, you want me to release Barabbas or Jesus, the anointed one? And what did the people say? He said, for Pilate knew that for envy they had delivered him. And when he was set down in the judgment seat, his wife sent unto him, saying, have nothing to do with this just man, for I have suffered many things this day in a dream because of him. But the chief priests and the elders persuaded the multitude that they should ask Barabbas and destroy Jesus. And the governor answered and said to them, whither of the twain will you that I should release unto you? And they said, Barabbas. Why? How could the people be persuaded? The people that just a few days ago were crying, Hosanna. Hosanna meaning save us now. Salvation has come. The people were putting down palm branches in the way of Jesus as he came into Jerusalem. Why were they crying out for Barabbas? Because their hearts had been turned by the Pharisees and the Sadducees and the scribes. You see, Barabbas, you know what Barabbas was? Barabbas was basically a terrorist. He was an insurrection leader. He came out and he led people against the Roman government, and that's what the Jews thought that Jesus was going to come and do. They thought he was going to come and throw off the Roman government and lead an insurrection and free the people. But when they realized that he wasn't, that he came to bring peace, that he wasn't there to throw off the Roman government, they said, listen, we've got a choice. Do we want this man or do we want Barabbas? And the scribes and the Pharisees persuaded the people that they would rather have a murderer who would lead an insurrection to throw off the government than the Christ, the anointed one, the God-man, Jesus. And they cried out, give us Barabbas, because that's what it really wanted. And destroyed Jesus. And the governor answered and said, which of the two shall release to you? And they cried, Barabbas. And Pilate said to them, what shall I do with Jesus, which is called the Christ, which is called the Anointed One? And they all said unto him, let him be crucified. And the governor said, why? What evil has he done? Even Pilate, a pagan, a heathen, a non-believer, looked upon Jesus and said, what has he done wrong? I find no fault in this man. There's no reason to crucify him. But they cried out the more, saying, let him be crucified. And when Pilate saw that he could prevail nothing, but rather a tumult was made, there was a mob forming. They were about to tear the place apart. He took water and washed his hands before the multitude, saying, I am innocent of the blood of this just person. See ye to it. And listen, these people said words that they did not even understand the ramifications of what they called upon themselves. They answered all the people and said, his blood be upon us and upon our children. Whew. Did not know what they were saying. Then released he Barabbas unto them. And when he had scourged Jesus, he delivered him to be crucified. And then the soldiers of the governor took Jesus into the common hall and gathered unto him the whole band of soldiers. And they stripped him naked and put on him a scarlet robe. And when they had plaited a crown of thorns, they put it upon his head and a reed in his right hand. And they bowed the knee before him and they mocked him, saying, hail, the King of the Jews. And they spit upon him and they took the reed and they smote him on the head. And after that they had mocked him, they took the robe off of him and put on his own raiment upon him and led him away to crucify him. We all know what crucifixion is, right? We see the cross. We see, yeah, Jesus was nailed. They say, yeah, he had a crown of thorns on his head. They put a nail through his hand. They put nails through his feet. They put him on something that looked like that. We don't really know. We don't really understand what Christ went through. I want to take a moment and try to explain to you what Christ suffered. In this simple word we call crucifixion. We take it for granted so much what Christ did for us. You see, we look back and it says in verse 26 that they had scourged him. Let me explain to you what that meant. It said they scourged Jesus Christ. Scourging was a punishment that was so brutal in the Roman period that it was illegal for them to scourge a Roman citizen. If you were a citizen of Rome, it was illegal for them to scourge you because it was so brutal of a punishment. What would happen when they scourged a man is they would take him and they would strip him naked. They would take his clothes off of him, and two Roman soldiers would stand on either side with a cat of nine tails in each hand, one on this side and one on that side. Now, a cat of nine tails was not just a whip, it was a whip with nine leather bands in it. These nine leather bands were between 6 to 7 foot long. At the end of these bands, they had lead shot at the end to give them weight, and attached to the lead shot going down the leather strap were the bones of sheep and of cattle and sometimes even broken glass. And as they scourged a man, they took turns hitting him from the right and from the left. And with a 6 to 7 foot whip with nine strands on it full of broken shards of bone and glass, the Romans were experts at punishment. They knew how to just push a man to bring the utmost pain, the utmost torture, bring him to the brink of death without actually killing him. Because they were so long, they would whip. And as they whipped, that whip would wrap around his body. And the shards of bone and glass would dig into him, driven in by the lead weights. And as they snatched, the muscle under his skin would be pulled out in strands and strips. Nine times with every beating. A typical scourging consisted of 39 lashes. 39 lashes with a cat of nine tails. 351 individual lashes by the band with bone and glass cutting into his body every single time, pulling the muscle through the skin. You see, they did this on purpose because when they put the man on the cross, they wanted pieces of muscle hanging out through the skin because one of the things they loved to see, it was a torture for them. As they hung on the cross, the flesh was hanging out and the ravens and the birds would come and land on the person being crucified and pick at these pieces of flesh hanging out. 351 individual lacerations on our Savior. All over his body. Not just his back, not just his chest. His legs, his buttocks, his face, his neck, everywhere. Bleeding, torn to shreds. His skin was even not barely existent, just enough to hold it together to keep him from bleeding to death. And it says they took a crown of thorns and plaited it together. Now these thorns, if you go and you look up, you look online, you can find pictures of these thorns. They have this very specific thorn tree that grew in Israel at this time that was used for torture. Now what would normally happen was they take a strand of this thorn bush and they would whip a person with it. They would hit them in the legs and hit them in the back. But they took these thorns and they wove it together into a crown. And the way that this plant grows, these thorns are between 1.5 to 2 inches long. And the amount of plant that it would take to weave a crown to put on his head would have consisted of between 300 to 400 individual thorns between 1.5 and 2 inches long. And what they did when they would put it on his head and they said they took a reed and they beat it down into him. Now these thorns were so hard that the medical science says they were so hard that they would even pierce not just through the flesh, but these thorns were so hard they would pierce through the outer table of the skull, the outer layer of the bone, and be driven into his skull. skull, 300 to 400 individual thorns driven into the outer layer of the skull of my God. After he had been beaten with over 350 individual lashes, his skin being torn from him. And then they mocked him. As he was sitting there, a shell of a man, torn to ribbons and shreds, they beat him. It says they hit him with their hands, hit him in the face, they punched him, they spit upon him. It says in one place that they took and they plucked his beard out by their hands. I've had my beard pulled before. Let me tell you something, these hairs are in a lot tighter than the ones up here. I can't even imagine having your beard ripped from your face. And then they took him. They mocked him. They took the robe off of him. And they led him out to crucify him. What they would do, they would take this cross. Really looked a little bit different than this. It was in two pieces. They would have a big pole, a post, at the site of the execution. And the crossbar would be brought to the criminal. The crossbar, if you can imagine in your head, the closest thing to it is like a cross tie, a railroad cross tie. It would have weighed about 150 or more pounds. Rough cut in wood. After Jesus Christ had been beaten, you picture the state of his back with the muscle and flesh hanging. And they took this rough 150 plus pound cross tie and they laid it upon his back and they said, carry it. And this was nothing more than humiliation, because they knew at this point that anyone who had been beaten this badly could not make it the 2 miles down the road to Golgotha. And that's why Jesus stumbled as he walked. And it says that as he went out his way, as they came out, they found a man of Cyrene, Simon by name, and him they compelled to bear his cross. And when they were coming to a place called Golgotha, which is to say a place of a skull, they gave him vinegar to drink mingled with gall. And when he tasted thereof, he would not even drink of it. You see, what it skips over in Matthew is the fact that when they put him on the cross, it just jumps ahead to when he's already on the cross. But let me explain something to you. Like I said a minute ago, these Romans were masters of torture. You see, they had practiced crucifixion for hundreds of years. They had it down to a science. We know that they'd put nails through his hands and through his feet. But it's not as simple as that. You see, my Savior was put upon this cross. And the Romans knew exactly what they're doing. If you put a nail right through the palm of a man's hand and you put all his weight upon it, it will simply rip right through his flesh and he will fall. The Romans figured out that if they went right here in the wrist, right between these two bones, between two arteries that run down. You see, they knew if they missed, if they hit an artery, he would bleed out too quickly and he would die without giving them the satisfaction of the torture that they wanted to give him. But if they put it right here, right in the middle, it would hold. There's a ligament in between these two bones that's strong enough to hold the weight of a man. But listen, the crazy thing about this, not only is it strong enough, not only did it give them a place to nail a person with, but it gave them extra satisfaction on the torturous aspect of it, because it went through the central nerve of the hand. Listen, I don't know if anybody ever has experienced something called carpal tunnel. Carpal tunnel syndrome is because of this nerve that runs right through the hand, this main nerve, and it hurts. I've never experienced it, but I heard it hurts. But see what the Romans did, they took that spike and they drove it straight through the nerve. The doctors say that if a man was driven a spike through this hand, right through that median nerve, it would cause the sensation most similar to an electric cattle prod being stuck into your hand. Non-stop. After he had been beaten, the nails were driven through these nerves in his hands. The sensation of an electric cattle prod shooting through him. And then they nailed his feet. And the same thing happened with his feet. They went in between the first and second metatarsal. And they went and put it straight through another nerve called the plantar nerve. Maybe some of you experienced something called plantar fasciitis. If you have, you know it hurts. But could you imagine the nail, the spike being driven straight through the plantar nerve of the foot? Again, that same sensation of an electric cattle prod. From the instant that nail was driven through that nerve to the point that he drew his last breath, intense, searing agony, nonstop. And then they attached the crossbar to the cross with him nailed to it. And they lifted him up with two hooks. They would take a hook and they would hook it to the crossbar and they would lift it up and lift it up and lift it up. And the cross would come up, and just as it reached vertical, it would drop into the hole. Boom! And all of his weight would jar across those nails that were driven into him. And let me tell you something. The most brutal part of a crucifixion is this. It's the way it actually caused death. Because the beating brought you close to death, but it didn't kill you. The nails brought you agony, but they did not kill you. They were very careful about that. The way the cross killed you was this. When you were suspended on the cross by these four points, the 2 feet and the 2 hands, the body sinks into a position where the diaphragm extends down into the abdominal cavity. That makes it so it's very easy to take a breath in. The diaphragm is what allows your lungs to fill and allows you to breathe. And your diaphragm sinks down. And as Jesus was hanging in the cross, it was easy for him to take a breath in, but it was impossible for him to take a breath out, to exhale. So every time he breathed in, he would have to pull himself up on these nails. Pull himself up on these nails driven through his nerves. All of his body weight resting against them to lift himself up to exhale. Do you know what that means to me? Listen to me. On the cross, Jesus spake very few words. But every word that Jesus spoke on the cross was spoken in agony. The most extreme agony that a person can ever imagine. Because every word that Jesus spoke on the cross was spoken from the position of him pulling himself up across his own nails just so he could get the words out. Let me tell you something. Those words he spoke on the cross are so precious. The most intense agony a person could ever imagine. So Jesus is hanging on the cross. And they gave him vinegar to drink mixed with gall. Now in other gospels it says it was mixed with myrrh. That was given as a painkiller to numb him. To numb his body and his mind. Jesus refused to drink it. He refused to have his pain deadened. He allowed himself to feel the full weight of that agony as he died. And they crucified him. They parted his garments, casting lots, that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by the prophet. They parted my garments among them, and upon my vesture they did cast lots. And sitting down, they watched him there. And they set up over his head an accusation written, "This is Jesus, the King of the Jews." And there were 2 thieves crucified with him, one on the right and the other on the left. Now I just told you, the words of Jesus spoken on the cross were spoken in such intense agony. He had to lift himself up just to get his words out. And we see, then Luke chapter 23, verse 34. I'm going to reference different gospels, because to get all the words that Jesus spoke, you have to use the different gospels. They're not all listed in each one. The very first words that Jesus spoke on the cross, as he's hanging there, he lifts himself up, and with a single breath, in Luke chapter 23, verse 34, he says the most unimaginable thing that I could fathom. After all this has been done to him, guess what he says? He says, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." Listen, just like those people a minute ago, they cried out and they said, Let his blood be upon our heads. Let his blood be upon our heads and our children's heads. They did not realize the ramifications of what they were doing. They did not understand that they were not just killing a man. They were killing a God man. Now listen to me. Jesus was 100% man and 100% God. When he died on this cross, he experienced it as a man, 100% physically. But he was still 100% God at the same time. And he lifted himself up and he said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. They do not even understand what's happening here today. And it says they were put between two thieves that crucified him, one on the right and one on the left. And they that passed by reviled him, wagging their heads and saying, Thou that destroyest the temple and buildest it in 3 days, save thyself. If you're really the Son of God, come down from the cross. Likewise, the chief priests mocking him with the scribes and elders said, He saved others. Himself he cannot save. If he be the King of Israel, let him come down from the cross, and then we'll believe him. Physician, heal thyself. He trusted in God, let him deliver him now, if he will have him. For he said he was the Son of God. And the thieves also, which were crucified with him, cast the same in his teeth. And the Gospel of Matthew leaves out the next words of Jesus Christ, which were spoken in Luke chapter 23, verse 43. When the second thief on the cross stopped. See, the one thief on the cross, he copied the scribes and the Pharisees and the people that were mocking him, saying, Hey, if you're really the Christ, come down. Hey, if you're really Jesus, if you're really the Son of God, let God pull you down off the cross. Hey, he saved others. Why can't he save himself? If he really healed people, let him heal himself. If he really raised Lazarus from the dead, surely he can get down from that tree. And the thief on the cross said, Hey, yeah, if you're really God, save us. And the other one on the other side says, basically, shut up. He said, Listen, don't you fear God? He said, We are getting what we deserve. But this man has done nothing wrong. And he looked at him and said, Master, remember me when you come into your kingdom. And the second set of words that Jesus spoke on the cross were these. He looked at the man and he said, Today you will be with me in paradise. Just picture these words. Picture him lifting himself up in agony. Just, I can picture just straining to even get these words out. Today you'll be with me in paradise. Even in death, even at the end, he shows how easy it is, how simple it is to receive him. We overcomplicate salvation. We make it too hard and too complicated. And we say, you got to do this. You got to say this prayer exactly right. And we try to explain it in all these different ways. It's simple. The Bible says the gospel of Jesus Christ was made simple to confound the wise. Out of the mouth of babes and sucklings, his word is proclaimed. The thief on the cross said nothing but simply that he believed that he was true. He believed that he was God. He believed that he was a righteous man, that he had done no wrong. He was hanging on the cross for no reason other than that he let himself be put there as a sacrifice for our sins. And he said, Master, remember me. And Jesus said, And today you'll be with me in paradise. Salvation is simple. Salvation is simple. But after this, it says, Now, from the sixth hour, there was darkness over all the land unto the ninth hour. For 3 hours, it said the sky grew black. The sun was blotted out of the sky. And in the ninth hour, Jesus spoke his next set of words. In the ninth hour, in verse 46, it says Jesus spoke his next set of words. And listen to me, let me tell you something. The set of words that he spoke next are some of the most heart-wrenching words to me that Jesus spoke on the cross. Listen, the words he spoke on the cross were precious. The words he spoke on the cross were powerful. But these words that he's about to speak to me, these are gut-wrenching because I understand what he means when he says this. A lot of people don't understand what he meant. The people that were there that stood and watched him while he spoke those words did not understand what he meant. They didn't understand what he was saying. But I understand, and it wrenches my gut every time I think about it. As Jesus was there in the ninth hour, he cried out from the cross, "Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani." That means, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? And some people don't understand. They say, God didn't forsake him. He was God. How can God forsake God? He was him. But you don't understand, listen, Jesus was God, but Jesus was also man. He was 100% God, he was 100% man. And in this moment, he became the supreme sacrifice for all of our sins. My sins and your sins and your sins and your sins and your sins and yours and yours and every single person here and every single person that's ever been born on the face of this earth, our sins were laid upon his back. And in that moment, Jesus Christ had his very deity stripped from him, and his very Godhead stripped from him. And God the Father could not look upon the sin that was laid upon his Son. And in that moment, having his deity stripped from him, having the sins of the whole world laid upon his shoulder, Jesus Christ, the man, at one moment separated from God his Father, who is always connected to from the very beginning, looked out and he said, my God, why have you forsaken me? And he did this for me. And he did this for you. God allowed his very deity, his very Godhead, to be stripped away from him so that our sins could be laid upon his back. And it was not that the Father forsook him. It's that for the first time and the only time in all of history, the Son was separated from the Father because of our sins. He did this for us. I can't believe he would do that for me. That God would allow himself to go through this for me. It blows my mind. And after he spoke these words, some of them stood there. They heard what he said. He said, this man calls for Elias. He calls for Elijah. They didn't understand. And straightway one of them ran and took a sponge and filled it with vinegar and put it on a reed and gave it to him to drink. But the rest said, hey, stop, let him be. Let us see if Elias will come and save him. They mocked him again. Let's see if Elijah will save him. And listen here. This is the last words. It does not say here, but it does say in John chapter 19, verse 30. It says, after he had cried out, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? And he said in one part, in another gospel, he said, Father, into thy hands I commit my spirit. And at the very end, after they tried to give him some more wine to drink, something else to ease his pain. It says at the very final end, the final words of Jesus Christ. Matthew does not tell what they are. Matthew simply says he cried out with a great loud voice. But John chapter 19 verse 30 tells us the final words of Jesus Christ as he gave his last breath. As he was sitting there. He pulled himself up one final time upon those nails that held him. And he, with his very last dying breath, he said the words, "It is finished." And he gave up the ghost, and he gave up his life, and he breathed his last breath, and he died. But let me tell you something here. Do you know what he meant? Do you know what he meant when he said it is finished? Most people wrongly assume he simply meant he was dying. This is it. I'm gone. I'm dead. It's finished. It's over. My last heartbeat is beaten. My last breath has been breathed. It's time for me to go. It's time for me to die. It's finished. No, that's not what he meant. Let me tell you what he meant. Listen, this makes me so excited. That's why I love preaching this. This is why I want to tell you this morning. That's why I'm so excited. When Jesus Christ died on the cross with his very last breath, he lifted himself up and he said, "It is finished." And let me tell you what was finished in that moment. In that moment, the wrath of God was finished. In that moment, the wrath of God was completed. For all of creation, mankind had sinned. And the wrath of God had built up and built up and built up. And mankind had a punishment to pay. The wrath of God had to be fulfilled. The wrath of God against us, against our sins, that punishment is hell, death, eternal separation from God. But when Jesus Christ, he breathed his last breath, he cried out, "It is finished." And not in the sense that his life was finished, in the sense that the sacrifice was finished. God's wrath was finished. God's wrath was completed. No longer did God hold his wrath against man, because Jesus Christ had made the sacrifice. He had made a way out. He had made a way for man to reach God. And in that moment, God's wrath was finished. It was over. No longer was hell the only option for mankind. No longer was man separated from God. No longer was God's wrath stored up to be poured out. It was finished. And behold, the veil of the temple was rent in twain from the top to the bottom. And the earth did quake, and the rocks rent, and the graves were open, and many bodies of the saints which slept arose, and came out of the graves after his resurrection, and went into the holy city, and appeared unto many. And now the centurion and they that were with him watching Jesus, when they saw the earthquake and those things which were done, they feared greatly, saying, "Truly this was the Son of God." Even the Roman centurion, when he saw everything that happened, he said, "Truly, this was the Son of God." And he was taken. He was taken off the cross. And Mary and the women came. And a rich man named Joseph of Arimathea came and begged Pilate for the body. He said, "Let me take his body. Let me put it in my own grave. I've got a place for it." He was laid in a borrowed tomb. The next day was the Sabbath. The Sabbath day. So they wanted him to come and be done away with quickly, because you couldn't work on the Sabbath. So they took him, and they took, and it says Nicodemus, the man who came to him by night. You know what he said? John 3:16, the most famous verse in the Bible that was spoken to Nicodemus. It said Nicodemus came with over 100 pounds of precious myrrh and aloes, and they put it on his body, and they wrapped him in clean linen, and they laid him in the tomb, in a borrowed tomb, the tomb of Joseph of Arimathea. And the women came, and they poured spices, and they poured oil, and they put them in the tomb. And the scribes and the Pharisees came, and they said, "Listen," they said, "hey, we're scared that somebody's going to steal his body, because they promised he's going to rise from the dead," or something stupid like that, some foolishness. And we know he's not going to rise from the dead, but his disciples may come and steal his body. So listen, Pilate, can you give us some guards, give us some soldiers to go guard this dead man? So he said, "Okay, I'll give you some. Go make it as sound as you can." So they took a stone, and they rolled the stone in front of the opening of the tomb, and they sealed it. They put a seal upon it, and they put soldiers in place to guard the dead man. And night fell, and that was the end. That was the end. That was the end of Friday. Now, Paul tells us, if the story had ended here, Paul tells us that if Jesus Christ did not rise from the grave, then we would be, of all people, most miserable. He says in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 16, Paul said, "For if Christ did not rise, if the dead do not rise, then Christ is not risen. And if Christ be not risen, then your faith is in vain. And yea, you are yet in your sins. And they which also are fallen asleep in Christ are perished. Listen, if in this life only we have hope in Christ, we are of all men most miserable. If that was the end, we would have no hope. We would have no joy. We would have reason to be miserable. But that's not the end of the story. That's not the end of the story. Matter of fact, it's just the end of the beginning. Let me read you something. In this moment, at the end of Friday, Christ is dead and buried, and people are questioning. No man can put the emotion into words of what the people are feeling like a pastor I know called S.M. Lockridge, who wrote this beautiful poem that I want to read to you right now. Because this, what I just read to you, happened on Friday. And S.M. Lockridge put this down into words. He said it like this. He wrote this poem. He said, "It's Friday. Jesus is praying. Peter's sleeping. Judas is betraying. But Sunday's coming. It's Friday. Pilate is struggling. The council is conspiring. The crowd is vilifying. And they don't even know that Sunday's coming. It's Friday. The disciples are running like sheep without a shepherd. Mary is crying. Peter is denying. But they don't know that Sunday's coming. It's Friday. The Romans beat my Jesus. They robe him in scarlet. They crown him with thorns. But they don't know that Sunday's coming. It's Friday. See Jesus walking to Calvary. His blood dripping. His body stumbling. And his spirit burdened. But you see, it's only Friday. Sunday is coming. It's Friday. The world is winning. The people are sinning. And evil is grinning. It's Friday. The soldiers nail my Savior's hands to the cross. They nail my Savior's feet to the cross. And then they raise him up next to criminals. It's Friday. But let me tell you something. Sunday is coming. It's Friday. The disciples are questioning what has happened to their king. And the Pharisees are celebrating that their scheming has been achieved. But they don't even know that it's only Friday. And Sunday is coming. It's Friday. See him hanging on the cross. Feeling forsaken by his Father. Left alone and dying. Can nobody save him? Oh, it's Friday, but Sunday is coming. It's Friday. The earth trembles. The sky grows dark. My King yields his spirit. It's Friday. Hope is lost. Death has won. Sin has conquered. And Satan is just laughing. It's Friday. Jesus is buried. A soldier stands guard, and a stone is rolled into place. But you see, it's only Friday. Sunday is coming. Let me tell you something, people. Sunday has come. And that's why we're here today. And in the Gospel of John, chapter 20, we see that Sunday came. Listen, turn with me to your Bibles, the Gospel of John, chapter 20. And I want to read you this. After Friday came and that long day in between, the Gospel of John, chapter 20, comes in. And in the Gospel of John, chapter 20, it says this. When Sunday came, it says, on the first day of the week cometh Mary Magdalene early when it was yet dark to the sepulcher. And she see the stone taken away from the tomb. And she ran and came to Simon Peter and the other disciple who Jesus loved, named John. And said unto them, listen, they have taken away the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they've laid him. Peter therefore went forth, and the other disciple John, and they came to the tomb. And so they ran both together. And John outran Peter, and he came to the sepulcher, and he stooped down, and he looked down, and he saw the linen clothes lying, and he did not go in. And then came Simon Peter following after him. And he went into the tomb, and he saw the linen clothes lying, and Jesus was gone, and the napkin that was about his head, not lying with the other clothes, but wrapped up and put in a place by itself. And then John went in the tomb too, And then he believed. He saw he was gone. But as yet, it said they knew not the scripture that he must rise again from the dead. They didn't understand at this point that Jesus was supposed to rise, even though he told them. Even though he told them, they still didn't get the point. Peter and John and Mary all ran down to the tomb and they said, "Oh my God, somebody's stolen his body. We don't know where they've taken him. Where'd he go?" Even though Jesus told them what was going to happen, they didn't understand. They didn't believe. They didn't know. So what do? It says, after they saw the empty tomb, John and Peter simply went home. They went home to their own house. And they left Mary standing outside the tomb, weeping. Mary was standing outside the tomb, just crying. She did not know where they had taken her Lord's body. She did not know where the body of Jesus had been taken. She thought it had been stolen. She thought the Romans had taken it and put it somewhere else. And as she's standing there, she says she looked down into the tomb. And she saw two angels in white sitting, one at the head and one at the feet where the body of Jesus was laying. And they said unto her, "Woman, why weepest thou?" And she said unto them, "Because they have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they put him." Still, she did not understand. She said, "They've taken away his body. I don't know where he's at." And when she had said thus, listen to this. Listen, people. Listen, when she had said this, she turned herself around and she saw Jesus standing and she did not know it was him. Listen, hey, I want you to pay attention to me right now. This is where it gets exciting. This is what I want you to hear today. We're wrapping things up here. This is the most important part. This is what I want you to pay attention to. If you're falling asleep, if you're getting tired, I want you to wake up, open your eyes, pay attention to me right now, because this is what I want you to hear today. It says she looked at Jesus and she did not recognize him. And then it says, Jesus said unto her, "Woman, why weepest thou? Why are you crying, Mary? Whom seekest thou?" Who are you looking for? She, supposing him to be the gardener, said unto him, "Sir, if thou hast borne him hence, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away." Listen, it said she looked at Jesus and she didn't recognize Jesus. And Jesus spoke to her and she didn't realize that Jesus was speaking to her. But then look what happened. It said Jesus said unto her, "Mary." And she turned herself and said unto him, "Rabboni," which is master. You see, she saw him and she didn't recognize him. He spoke to her and she didn't recognize him. But listen to me, church. Then he called her by her name. And when he called her by her name, she recognized him, that he was God. Listen, let me tell you something. Maybe you have seen or heard of Jesus. Maybe you've been told about him. Maybe you've come to church and you've learned about him. Maybe you've even seen him. I guarantee you, you've seen him. You go outside and you see his handiwork all around you. Maybe God has spoken to you. Maybe he's tried to tell you something. Maybe he's tried to tell you you need to be saved. Maybe he's tried to speak to you and you still didn't recognize him as God. But listen, let me tell you something, church. Today, he is calling every single one of us by your name. He called me by my name. He said, "Brandon." And when he called me by my name, I heard him and I recognized that he was God. And let me tell you something. He is a personal God. He is a personal Savior. And he calls each and every single one of us by our name. And today, if you do not know him, he is calling you by your name. Brandon, Blake, Blaine, Stevie. He's saying, "Come, come to me." You see, Mary didn't recognize him when she saw him. She didn't recognize him when he spoke to her. But when he called her by her name, she recognized him as the only begotten Son of God. And she looked at him and she cried out, "Rabboni, Master." And she ran to hug him and she just loved him. He wept at his feet and she knew that her God had been risen from the grave and that he was alive. Let me tell you something, people. We just read that verse that Paul said, if we are Christians, call ourselves Christians, if Christ is not risen from the dead, then we are of all people most miserable. And if Christ did not rise from the dead, we have good reason to be miserable. To come into church sad and upset and mad and looking at her watch and saying, oh my God, he's taking way too long. The children are getting restless. The supper's getting cold. I'm ready to get out of here. This pew's getting hard. Listen, I know we've only got one service today, but have you got to make it the length of two? Listen, I'm ready to go home. Guys, if Jesus was not risen from the dead, you got reason to be angry today. You got reason to look like you've been sucking on a sour lemon all week. You got reason to be miserable. But listen, our God is alive. He is alive and well, and he has called us by our name, and he has called us to salvation. And let me tell you something, I'm excited, and I hope that I never get over. I know that I never will. I hope that you're excited today. I hope that you never get over this excitement, because listen, we serve a risen Savior. That's why we celebrate Easter. He is not dead. He's alive. Every single other God, every single other prophet that has ever walked the face of this earth is dead and laying in the grave. They did not come back. Muhammad didn't come back. Buddha didn't come back. Krishna didn't come back. Reverend Moon didn't come back. Joseph Smith didn't come back, but Jesus Christ, he's alive and he's well and he's living in heaven today. And listen, let me tell you something. We serve a risen Savior. The Bible says, let me read you. Let me tell you what the Bible says. I'm about to get excited here in a second. Let me tell you what the Bible says. Let me tell you what the Bible says. And maybe you'll get excited too. I hope you do. You see, in 1 Peter, 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 3, the Bible says this. Give me just a second to get there. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 3, it says, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, which according to his abundant mercy hath begotten us again." Listen, made us alive again. We've been born again. We've been born again. Nicodemus didn't understand that when Jesus first said it to him. He said, "You got to be born again." He said, "What you mean? I got to go back up in my mom and be born again?" He said, "No, you got to be born in the Spirit again." He said, but listen to this. "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, which according to his abundant mercy hath begotten us again unto a lively hope." A lively hope, not a dead hope, a living hope. A lively hope. By the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. We have a living faith, a living hope, because Jesus Christ is alive. If he was still dead, then we can act like dead people. But he's alive, so let's be alive today. It says, "To an inheritance incorruptible and undefiled that fadeth not away, reserved in heaven for you, who are kept by the power of God through faith unto salvation, revealed in the last time, wherein you stand and greatly rejoice." Listen to me, people. Today is Easter Sunday, Resurrection Sunday, and I believe every single one of us should be standing and rejoicing. Today is a day unlike any other. Today is a day of celebration that we should be excited, because Jesus Christ is alive. And because he's alive, that means we can live too. If he was still dead, we'd have no hope. But because he's alive, we've got a living hope. So he said, "Stand and rejoice." He said, even if need be, we greatly rejoice, though now for a season, if need be, you're in heaviness through manifold temptations. He said, even though you may be going through trials, even though you may be going through temptations, I don't know your circumstances today, but everybody goes through junk. Everybody goes through tough times. Everybody goes through hardship. Listen, I try not to complain. Sometimes I do, but I try not to. You know why? Because nobody wants to hear about it. Nobody cares in the beginning, because everybody goes through stuff. That's just called life. You going through hardship? Yeah, you probably are. It ain't the first time, is it? No? Guess what? It won't be the last time either. As long as we're here on this earth, we go through hard times. And he says, listen, even if for a little while you may have heaviness in your heart through the stuff that you're going through, even in that heaviness, we can stand and rejoice, because our God is alive. Our God is alive. He says, "Rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I say rejoice," no matter what's happening, no matter what situation you find yourself in, through the death of a loved one, through disease, through financial difficulty, through no matter what comes your way. You say, listen, Really, in all circumstances? Look at the world around us. Look what we got. We got Corona. Who cares about Corona? We got Jesus. Listen, all these new things are being passed. The new government, new people in government, new laws being passed. Who cares about the laws? We got Jesus. Well, what if they went? What if they changed them even worse? What if it got even more liberal? What if they went all the way over here? What if they passed laws and said you couldn't preach in the name of Jesus Christ? You couldn't preach against homosexuality. It'd be a hate crime. Couldn't preach against this. They'd throw you in prison. You know what? Bless God. Paul and Silas were put in prison, and guess what they were doing? They were singing and praising God at midnight, shouting the roof off of that place. No matter what situation we find ourselves in, we still serve a living God. Amen? Can you say amen today? Can you be excited? You know what I get tired of? You know what I get tired of? I get tired of dead Christians coming to dead churches, singing dead songs, praying dead prayers, sitting under dead leadership, listening to dead sermons, and going out living a dead faith in worship to a dead God. But listen, that is not us today, because we serve a living God, and our faith should be alive, and our prayers should be alive, and our songs should be alive, and our sermons should be alive, and bless God, our church should be alive, because we worship a living God. Amen? All right. Whew. I'm almost done. One more verse for you. One more verse for you. And we're going to wrap it up. Back in 1 Corinthians chapter 15. We read from there just a minute ago. 1 Corinthians chapter 15. Listen. Whew, this is it. This is why we can be happy today. This is why we can celebrate, guys. We can celebrate because in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 54, it says this. So when this corruptible shall have put on incorruption, and this mortal shall put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death! Where is your sting? O grave, where is your victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, through which giveth us the victory through Jesus Christ our Lord. Therefore, my beloved brethren, be ye steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, for as much as you know that your labor is not in vain. O death, where is your sting? O grave, where is your victory? Listen to me. I know what it's like to lose loved ones. I know what it's like to lose family members. It hurts. It stings. But let me tell you something. Because Jesus Christ conquered death, it takes the sting out of death. Because listen, if we know that our loved ones are saved, we know we'll see them again. Listen, I've never faced death myself. Maybe you have. Maybe you've been close. Maybe you're close right now. I don't know your situation. And people fear death more than anything else in this world. But let me tell you something. If you got Jesus Christ, he takes the sting out of death. You don't have to fear it because the sting is gone. Oh, grave, where is your victory? Listen, we have been given the victory because Jesus Christ has defeated death, hell, sin, and the grave. And he's given us a new life. If you don't know him today, I could think of no better day than Resurrection Sunday. Listen, he's calling you by your name. He's calling you by your name today. Will you recognize him? Will you come to him? He takes away the sting of death. You don't have to fear it anymore. He takes away the power of sin. You don't have to be a slave to it anymore. He takes away the grave. It doesn't have to be your home anymore. He'll give you a new one. He takes away the stony heart. He gives you a new heart. He gives you a new life. He gives you everything, people. Will you come to him today? If you do, guess what? You gain the victory. The victory over death, hell, and the grave. Because he won it. When he went out on that cross, and when he come out of that tomb, he won the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. Up from the grave he arose. What a mighty triumph for his foes. He arose the victor over the dark domain, and he lives forever with his saints to reign. Are you one of his saints today? Listen, we're going to play a song, and this altar is going to be open. If you don't know him today, you need to come, people. You need to come and you need to know him today. And let me tell you something, church. If you do know him, act like he's alive. Act like he's alive, amen? Because he is. We don't serve a dead God. We serve a risen Savior, amen? As they come, they're going to play and this altar is going to be open. I urge you today, come get a one-on-one with God. Doesn't matter. Just come talk to him. Allow him to move through you. If you do not have a relationship with Jesus Christ, and you say, Pastor, I want to be saved. I don't know how. It's simple. It's so simple. I'm not going to make you repeat after me. I don't do that. It's not my style. I'm not going to make you repeat magic words because it's not in the words. Listen, if you want to come and get saved today, you can come and grab me by the hand. I'll be happy to pray with you. But you know, all you have to do is pour out your heart towards God. A, B, C, admit, believe, confess. Admit that you're a sinner, that you're lost, and you're on your way to hell. Believe that Jesus is who he said he is, and he did what he said he did. And confess. Confess your sins to him. Ask him to forgive you. Ask him to be your Lord and Savior. And give your life to him. Do that in your own words. Just as the thief on the cross did, you can do that today. And then come tell us. If you do, come tell us and we can rejoice with you. Amen. They're going to play. This altar's open.
That paid my way, death its price. When it flowed down from the cross, my sins were gone, my sins were gone. There is a grave that tried to hide this precious blood that gave me life. But in 3 days he breathed again and rose to stand in my defense. So I come to tell tear that falls. So I come to tell you that he saves, to shout and to proclaim that he's coming back for you. There is a light that sights the blind, cleanse my
nothing,
nothing but the blood of Jesus.
Nothing.
What can make me whole again?
Nothing but the blood.
Absolutely nothing
but the blood. Nothing but the blood.
There is a grave that tried to hide this precious blood that gave me life, but in 3 days he breathed again and rose to stand in my defense. So I come to tell you
he's alive.
He's coming back for you. So I come to tell you.